Welcome to the Harley Flanagan Show. People always ask me about what were some of the biggest shows or most important shows that you played, like, you know, because I toured with a lot of big bands, you know, with Motorhead, you know, a lot of stuff. King Diamond. I played with a lot of metal bands. For a dude who pretty much played hardcore, Cro-Mags did wind up touring with a lot of metal bands. You know, we played with Megadeth. I can't even think of all of them. But there was one show that I always remember. It was Christmas on Earth in Leeds. I believe it was 1987. And yeah, anybody who was there will tell you it was a massive, it was the first show of its kind, really. It was like the first international thrash metal extravaganza. You know, you had bands from all over the world. You know, from America, you had Megadeth, they were the headliners. You had we played, Cro-Mags played, Nuclear Assault played, I believe Rockets, bands from Italy, Voivod was supposed to play. There was a lot of great bands, and it was just it was insanity, and it was the first time I had ever done a show like that. And one of the bands that played that I became good friends with and still am good friends with was Virus. So yeah, you know, and it's crazy because back then, you know, Virus is from England, and a lot of those early thrash metal crossover metal type people from the UK were former punk rockers, you know. There was a time when, you know, people who were listening to Venom and people who were listening to Motorhead, a lot of them had been punk rockers and vice versa. You know, actually a lot of the metalheads were more working class than a lot of the punk rockers, who a lot of them were actually middle class. And then you had, you know, well, you had bands like Virus who grew up with punk, just like Venom. You know, Kronos was, he was into punk rock and he was a skinhead back in the old days. You know, all these guys were hooligans, you know, they were all nuts. And they just wound up starting bands. And you know what? Speaking of these lunatics, let me see if I can contact one of them. Let me see if this is gonna go through. Reception's not so good. What can I tell you? It's not like my city home. Where is this fucking guy? Come on, Henry. What the fuck could you possibly do? I may have to hit him later. It's early afternoon. Oh, shit, there he is.
I could hear what you're saying, by the way.
Wait a second.
You know, I got you. Me like that again, I'll fuck you up.
Yeah, well, you're gonna have to jump on a plane first. Ah, man, the glare.
Right?
So I was just talking about how.
What?
Say what now?
Oh.
Oh, fuck. I was just talking about how a
can
lot...
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Henry. Henry, my love. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Yes, I can hear you.
I can hear you. Then we're all good. All right.
Okay.
Now, I was just telling these people how in those early days of thrash metal or crossover metal, whatever the hell you want to call it, how a lot of the early metalheads in that scene were former punk rockers. And I know that Kronos from Venom was an old punker, and he used to be a skinhead, and you know, was a big soccer hooligan. And I know a lot of people who went from punk rock to metal. Now, me and you were talking about a lot of punk bands that we both grew up listening to. So why don't you tell us a little bit about how that transition happened, where all the punks started going more metal over in the UK?
That's actually a very good question, Harley. You know, back in the day, it was all, you know, God, Beatles and the Clash and the Buzzcocks. And, you know, I was 14. 15 years of age, used to make ourselves older. We could get into a club.
I can't tell if it's the reception or if it's your fucking accent, but this is going to be difficult. Try me again.
Hello?
Yes. Speak. Ah, fuck. Technology. Huh?
Yeah, can you hear me now?
I can hear you now. What the hell you got going on over there?
A lot of heat.
A lot of heat. So talk to me.
A lot of fire. Can you see me now?
Now I can hear you. I can see you. You're beautiful.
Hang on. let me go back. Can you see my full body?
You sexy beast.
Well, I'm not going to fucking move now, then. I'd love to show you my home, but at some point, you two are going to have to come here.
Yeah, okay? I'll be out there soon enough, man. We'll be playing guitars and shooting guns in no time.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And so I was saying, I mean, the whole point of punk rock back in England, and this is my opinion only, no one else's, because... God damn it, you say anything these days, you get fucking destroyed, you know?
Oh, that's the story of my life, bro.
Yeah. So I think it all got fragmented. It went to the like the Crusties, which was Crass, and the Anarchos, which was Conflict. And then to me, the real punk was the Buzzcocks and... the Sex Pistols and the Clash,
and then it started getting
all that. Then,
it started getting all politicized and hippied out.
Yeah, it all just went fucking everywhere. It went in all different directions, and suddenly this fucking thing came out from New York and America called thrash metal, New York hardcore, and all that sort of stuff. And we're like, fuck, we can play that, you know?
But
because I'll tell you what, Harley. The English, we ain't bad musicians, mate. We can fucking play anything.
But you know what? I really think we owe most of this to Motorhead. You know, whether it's whether it's American hardcore or English, the Brit, you know, all of that shit. I
could tell you many stories about Lemmy. I used to drink with him when he was playing his fruit machines, which a fruit machine in American terms is like a slot machine, you know, different terminology. But he was a great guy.
May his soul rest in peace. And
yes.
All of those guys,
but, you
man.
Know, I know you guys played with him, and that's the first time I ever saw you do that You Gotta Know video in black and white. Is it with Chris Williams, I think it was?
Oh, that was our old manager. Fucking hell. Yeah. I don't even know if he's alive or not.
Yeah, we're not going to go there, but there was one band I never actually played with. But we went on to do other things as such, you know. I won't say how successful we were, but...
Well, you look pretty... You don't look too bad off.
Really done, this is probably my first interview for 25, 30 years. I actually don't do interviews. I don't do them.
Yeah, well, I'm honored to have you on my show.
I will always remember this one fucking thing. Let me tell you. When we played in London that first time, right? And I will always say this. I mean, we were one of the first bands that supported a great band from fucking New York, which was the Cro-Mags. And that was a fantastic fucking show. And you were, you know you were a fucking star. Then we went up to Leeds to do the fucking, am I allowed to swear?
Oh, please.
We went up to Leeds.
Fuck you. How's that for an answer?
It's like that festival up there.
That was like the first real...
The first metal one. It wasn't the first punk one.
No, but it was like
I did some research on it, and I remember the first one was a punk show called Punks on Earth or Christmas Punks on Earth or something like that. Then the metal guys just ripped it off or whatever, you know, and done the same thing. And it was in that old tram shed in Leeds. Up north.
We all stayed
in the Dragona Hotel.
Yep. Well, you know,
that was fucking brilliant. And you know, I know you had your windshield broken. There was a bit of violence involved, which wasn't.
Yeah, I don't even remember how that happened. I think that was. I don't even remember how the hell that happened. But it was a great show, man. I think that show really was a game changer. I mean, it. A lot of people had, for starters, nobody over there had ever seen a New York hardcore band before. That was the first time.
Only when that first show you did.
Yeah, but that was a small gig.
From my point of view, Harley, it was like, okay, I have one of the best fucking hardcore bands coming out of New York, coming to England, they've never played there. Then we get a call from Suicidal Tendencies. Go and play with you, right?
Fuck yeah.
So we done the first Suicidal Tendencies gig in, in London, and the fucking thing was a riot again, you know? And it was suddenly...
Fucking Americans,
man.
Momentum.
I took these guys out drinking, and I'm like, there's no fucking skateboards here, really, mate, you know? We're all soccer hooligans, you know? But, you know, it was a fantastic show. Like the one when you were there at the Cro-Mags, that was one of the best shows I will remember to the day that I die.
Definitely one of my top gigs.
It was absolutely fantastic, completely mental, you know. So,
well, I'm glad that we can share that memory with each other, and I look forward to doing some other crazy shit in the future, you know. Life is all kinds of good shit coming up.
I ended up playing with a load of other metal bands that were pretty, maybe I shouldn't say this, but they were like pussies, really. They were like Death Angel from San Francisco.
Those guys were cool, man. I like those kids.
Where they got booed off stage. You know?
Fuck, I like those kids. They're a good bunch of guys.
Yeah, from the Philippines or Indonesia or somewhere, but they got booed off stage. I remember we played a show in Wales and everyone was going crazy for us sort of thing, you know, and all that. But, I have many stories. It's why I'm probably going to write a book like you done, you know.
You should, man.
I've been quiet for 30 years. I'm just going to fucking say it all and I beat up a few journalists and all that, and they all know who they are and all that. But everyone's just dying and all that sort of shit these days, and it's like, there's not many of us left. So, what the fuck?
Hey, man, I got to ask you. I always talk to my friends about music, their influences, this, that, and the other. So I've been asking everybody 5 questions. I'm going to, and I didn't prepare you for this at all. So name your top 5 bands, and this can be of any genre, just like the top 5 bands that either like were your biggest influences or were just game changers. Your top 5, what are they?
My first one, number 1. Can I say number 1 first?
You could say number 1, or you don't have to put them in order. Do it how you want.
Well, I'll say Amy Whitehouse because I always loved a blowjob of her.
All right, that's number one. God bless her.
Can I say that?
You just did. You just did. This is live and direct, man.
Oh, this is live?
Well, as close as you can get to it. It's not exactly right, live, okay, but there's then. No editing.
Oh, shit. Is your wife listening?
Well, all right, you'll then. Find out later. All right, number two.
You know what?
What? Okay,
what?
All right, okay. Amy Winehouse, all right, number one.
That was a joke.
We know. He was only joking.
But,
Mrs. Heston, it was a joke.
Do I go from five down to one?
I don't care. Just give me your fucking five best fucking bands. You could go from five
fucking
to one.
Calm down, will you? It's all right. Hang on. Number one would be the Sex Pistols. Never mind the bollocks, mate. Because that changed my life.
Yes, I'm right there with you, brother.
Right. So, ain't got no problem with that. And I've been having a few drinks with Glenn Matlock, who used to play the bass.
No shit, yeah, man. He was a solid bass player.
I got to have that, and I'll say number two, this might surprise you, would be the UK Subs.
No, actually, you know what? That really doesn't surprise me because I saw them more times than I can count back in the day, and I've been friends with Charlie Harper since I was probably 11
and
or 12.
Nicky Garrett, who moved to New York.
Nicky Garrett was a nasty fucking guitarist, man. I saw him hanging upside down from the light rafters at CBGB's.
Then I would go for, like, the Damned.
I was just thinking the fucking Damned. You just stole that thought out of my brain. See, and the funny shit is you're a metalhead, and so far you're naming all punk
bands,
though.
In my head, that would make the top five.
Really?
No, absolutely not.
Are you fucking for real? Not even Sabbath or Motorhead?
No.
Really?
I grew up with punk, mate, and that was it.
No shit.
Do you know, out the top five would be a band called Cress.
Really? No fucking shit. Bloody Revolution. That, the first single, Bloody Revolutions
I tell you, the band that changed my life, like, from them first three that I just said, would be Discharge.
Absolutely. The Bones Brothers. Fuckers kick ass.
Then number five, my last five one would be like GBH.
Wow, man. I'm impressed. That's fucking awesome. See that? All you fucking metalheads out there? This is coming from one of the fucking OG motherfuckers.
Does that mean I'm biased?
Does that mean what?
Oh, I don't care about that. Does that mean I'm biased?
No, it means you've got taste.
Do you know what, Harley? I grew up with English punk, right? Can you hear me?
Yep.
And there was no mobile phones in them days, and you couldn't just call New York, you know. You had to go and find a phone box or whatever, you know.
Yeah, and so, here I am on my 10
know,
and my
we
Mac.
Maximum rock and roll. You know, there was no internet. There was no nothing. So I just loved what was playing. I used to go and see the Police. I fucking hated them.
You hated them?
You know,
I was
Police.
Just talking about what a fucking great drummer Stuart Copeland was yesterday.
He's fucking good. Well, I used to pay 50 cents to go and see him. Right? Fuck. I went in Atlanta, $350.
Where'd you see them play back home? You saw them at the Marquee?
No, they were playing in the local pubs back in the day. In them days, I used to go and see you two were playing everywhere. You know, what's his fucking name? The Irish fella. They were playing everywhere. They were supporting everywhere. I remember when you two supported Discharge.
Get the fuck out of here.
Can you believe that?
That's fucking
unbelievable. Right?
That is fucking crazy.
And I remember talking to the lead singer. Well, I can't think of his name now, but...
Bozo. Bono.
Yeah, because I've had a couple of beers, to be honest with you. Right, so I was at the bar with him, and I had a leather jacket on with all these spikes on it and all that, you know, and painting and all that sort of stuff. And he came up to me, he says, oh, we used to, and I had Discharger logo on it, you know. They're from Stoke up in England.
Yeah.
And he was going, oh, we supported them. And I said, I know, you support everyone. You fucking drive everyone crazy. You're the worst back ever. I've never liked them ever since.
Oh, I liked them. But you know who my favorite Irish... And, oh, wait, okay, wait. Did you name all five yet?
That, the biggest star to come out of Stoke is where Discharge comes from. Yeah, yeah. Is Slash. Slash from Guns N' Roses.
Get the fuck out of here.
You don't know that? Well, you go and check that out, right? If I'm wrong, you can kick my ass, all right?
Fucking Slash can't be from Stoke. Come on,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, no, he's English. He was born...
Bullshit. He was born in Stoke. Like Mexican or some shit.
No, he was born in Stoke. I'm bloody sure of it.
All right, we'll have to get back on this.
This is the biggest band who ever come out was Discharge, mate. One of my favorites.
One of my favorites,
too.
Hear Nothing, See Nothing, Say Nothing. One of the top albums ever.
Yep. Oh, I totally agree with you. My favorite track of all time is Ain't No Feeble Barters, No Fucking Scapegoat.
That's a fucking classic song, man.
Fucking brilliant. Not many people know that. That's like so many years ago, no one fucking knows. So I don't know.
Can you believe we're sitting here by our pools talking about Ain't No Feeble Bastard?
Are you recording this, by the way?
Yes. I just lost you again.
Oh,
there you go.
Are you recording this?
Yes, I am. I'm
going
to
tell you another funny story. Can I tell you another funny story?
Tell me another funny story.
Well, I was down in Brazil in a place called Sao Paulo. You ever heard of that place?
I've heard of it.
And I'm just walking around. It's a place called the Gallery of the Rock down there that a lot of your viewers probably know. And I'm walking around there, and all the public started going crazy because there was all these English punk rockers walking around. And then I'm like, sometimes you just don't meet people for 10 or 15 years or whatever. Suddenly, I saw a band called the Verrucas.
Oh.
A guy called Rat.
Yeah, yeah.
He's in there. And there's another guy, I can't remember his name there, but he plays in a band called Sick on a Bus, I think it's called. And they all turned up. I'm like, what the fuck are you doing here? And they said, Henry, what the fuck are you doing here? Oh, it was just unbelievable, mate. It was just fucking unbelievable. So, between me and you, Harley, we have a lot of fucking stories that we could write many books about, to be honest with you.
Hey,
maybe we should do a movie.
You know who I was talking about, too, the other day on one of my shows was... somebody that probably most American music fans are not familiar with, a DJ by the name of John Peel.
Oh, yeah, I know him. BBC.
BBC. I think he probably recorded more of the greatest, like, legendary bands than probably anybody.
When I was young, I used to listen in bed while I was sleeping. And you didn't have stereo back in them days. You had one earpiece, you put it in your ear, and I used to listen to Radio Luxembourg, because they used to have the pirate ships that done all the, they used to play all the punk rock and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, all
and
the pirate
John Peel
radio stations.
Was a great believer in punk rock, and his favorite band was...
The Undertones, from Ireland, motherfucker. Dude,
teenage kids.
I got a fucking great story for you, man. When I toured in Ireland in 1980 with one of my first punk bands, we were on a pirate radio station in fucking Belfast. And do you know how illegal that shit was back in 1980?
Dude, you're lucky to be alive.
Dude, we had to fucking... It was in the back of a fucking pub behind the pool table. Below the pool table, there was a panel on the floor. You could slide away. We had to get down on our knees, go through the fucking hole to the other room where they had the pirate radio station in the other fucking hidden room.
I tell you what, you were very young then. You were about 14, 15?
Fuck, man. I was like, I just barely turned 13, man. Fuck, I might have been, you know, I might have been fucking 12. I can't
remember. We are very similar, Harley. I done my first, well, my first release was when I was 14 on, I think it, what was it called? More Than Records. I was in a band called Criminal Damage, which was a punk band. And my first release was on a compilation, you know, with ABH and all these other punk bands. Because back in the day, it was all about, no one cares if you can play or not, just pick up the fucking guitar and go for it, you know?
Yeah, it was more about attitude than anything
else.
It
was about attitude, mate. It was about attitude.
Yeah.
Deep day, it's all about, what kills me these days, it's all about digital and all this, and you know, it's like, where you can play one riff for about 2 seconds, loop it, copy and paste it, and then you have a perfect album, you know?
Yeah, in a lot of ways, the integrity has been digitized right out of music. I mean, people today don't even really know, you know, they don't even know music history. Like, they just, you can search it, sample it, and you know, there's no connection to their roots.
You know, I may be a punk rocker, but I went and see ELO on Saturday, and you know, Jeff Lynne and ELO, the Electric Light Orchestra. If your viewers if they don't understand what ELO is, but they were an old band from the 70s, and you know, it just made me want to give up playing a, you know, being a musician or playing, because they were so brilliant, it was unbelievable. You know, yeah, I was just like, good God, you know. And you know why they sell out 20,000 stadiums? You know, they were just brilliant.
Well, that was one of the things that changed it for me when I got into the Pistols, was that I realized that you didn't have to be you know, you didn't have to be Carlos Santana, or you didn't have to be a John McLaughlin in order to write a good song. You could, if you had attitude and you could just pick a few notes that had a good chord progression to them, you know, you're good.
Did
man.
You did you meet Steve Jones in New York and all that sort of stuff?
I met him in New York. He used to hang out with my old guitarist Doug Holland. He was staying with him for a little while.
Yeah, Doug, he used to play with Krell.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and so. I used to hang out with Steve when he was in New York for a minute, but I never got to jam with him. I wish I could have. And you know, another guy who I thought was so underrated and was such a great player was, well, now I'm on drummers, is Paul Cook. What a fucking badass drummer, man.
And he was so solid.
And you know who was also fucking wicked? I got to watch him a couple times from the side of the stage when he was playing, was Topper from The Clash.
Yeah.
He was fucking wicked, man. Another really, we were talking about Irish bands before, fucking Stiff Little Fingers. I don't know how we left them out.
Oh, my God, Jake Burns.
Yeah, man, fucking hell. Kick-ass band.
Well, do you know what? They should have made my top 5 list. I forgot about them.
Well, you know
because
what?
Because there are. You next should have time... gave me a top 10, not a top 5. You know?
Absolutely. Well, look, bro, I'm going to fucking wrap this up.
Okay,
man. I got some dinner I want to eat. And I'm going to give you a call over the next day or two, man. Maybe we can
book. I just have to ask you one question.
Shoot.
I have to ask you one question. Do I look handsome?
You look beautiful. You're pale as fuck, though. I thought you had a lot of sun out there, man. Oh, I forgot. You English people don't get color.
Do you want to have a look around?
Show me a look around. Hopefully the fucking phone won't freeze. Oh, nice.
I'm in the fucking pool myself.
Yeah, you prick. I got my pool too, don't worry.
All right, you take care, my friend.
All right, brother. I'll speak to you soon. We'll continue this conversation about our top 10 next time.
Definitely, mate.
All right,
brother.
Anytime, mate.
Cheers,
bro. Thank you
very much.
Always good talking to you. Madman. Total madman. All right, well, took a minute to get this fucking phone working. I mean, this computer. And that was fun. So anyway, trying to turn all this madness off. Well, I hope you found that as enjoyable as I did. He's always fun to talk to. And until next time, I'll think of someone else to call and some more songs to play. Ah.